this is Pastor Sandra Kennedy here in Augusta, Georgia. We are excited about what God is doing. You know, every time I come to you, I basically end up saying how excited we are about the Lord. That's because we are standing and believing for an invasion of the Holy Spirit, and we are seeing God do wonderful things here at our church. And if ever you're anywhere in this area, you must come by to see us, because I promise you, not only do we have a healing center here that you can come to and people come to from all over the world, but in our church services, God is invading it, and we are understanding what it means to not only have a visitation from God, but to have a habitation of God, when He comes in and just stays. Am I right, church?
Yes.
Let them know y'all are here. Am I right?
Yes.
I mean, God wants to invade us so that He's a part of everything we do, everywhere we go, and every part of any part of our lives. You know, I used to, back in my, I grew up Baptist, and back, I used to hear people say things like, I don't want to bother God with that. I'll say, why don't you ask God about that? And it might be a small issue. I don't want to bother God with that. If you don't bother God with some small ones, you might as well forget the big ones. Because you've got to learn, that's how faith works. You learn by coming to God, and you're not bothering Him. He's your Father. And He wants to work on your behalf and show you how precious He is. He is a wonderful, miracle-working God. So you need to bring everything to Him. I was just saying before we actually began this taping, I was commenting about how wonderful it is to have angels live in your house and to help you find things you yourself can't find or point out things to you. You know, if you're not walking the Christian life and you're not walking where you are using all the benefits that God has given you, you are missing everything almost that God had in store for you. There's so many people that all they want to do is just make sure they get to heaven. Now, don't misunderstand me. That's a great thing. You know, I'm counting on that. But at the same time, there's much more than trying just to get out of hell. There's a life to be lived here. There is a fellowship with God here. There are angelic beings that He puts around you. You're never alone. You know, goodness and mercy follow you everywhere you go, the Bible says. You are never alone. The Holy Spirit's with you. Your own angel that came with you when you were born. Praise the name of the Lord. And I'm telling you, God has put a host of folks around you, and you are, even though you're there and you don't feel like you see anything or feel anything, that's not the point. It's a matter of by faith taking the Word of God, what God has said that He has done. Now, that's really what I want to talk to you, because there's nothing more important than that. It's what the Bible says. Look at your neighbor and say, it's what the Bible says. And if you don't read it, you'll never know it. Hallelujah. So I was thinking that I think I will just name this, Help, I'm Sick. Now, and the deal is, you don't ever want to say that.
Amen.
Hello? You can say, Help, the devil's trying to make me sick. Help, the devil is trying to make me confess that I'm sick. But you want to always say, Thank God I'm healed in the name of Jesus. You can make, this symptom may be coming on you, and you can get somebody to stand with you, but you don't ever, it's sort of like claiming your own diabetes or claiming your own cancer. Not, you don't want to claim that mess. It doesn't belong to you. Jesus died to take care of those things for us, and we have to learn in the name of Jesus how to let the Word of God overpower these other things in our lives. And you know, the problem with all of this is most of us go to churches or grew up where nobody ever taught us how to apply the Word for healing. And of course, you know, I teach it all the time, and we have a healing center that's here. But if you don't, we can have a healing center right here where people come from all over the world, and you can live a block away and not come. And that's not appropriating what God has made available. And that's where most people miss it. They don't either believe in it, meaning they don't believe that God's in the healing business. They don't believe that, someone told me just the other day, said, you know, I grew up and said, they teach me all the time that if it's God's will, I'll be healed. Well, we know the will of the Lord. I mean, the Bible came. I sent my son to heal you, my word, that you would be healed. Healing is in the atonement. We don't have to ask God, does He want to heal anybody? God's in the healing business. Now, then a lot of people say back to me, well, if that's so, then I guess we never have to die. Well, you dumb. We all go die someday. Hallelujah. But there's nothing that says you have to die sick. But you know, you can just say, well, I'm leaving in the morning. Praise God. Hallelujah. Just like, y'all got anything you want to say to me? Hallelujah. Anything you want to clear up? Glory to God. I'll be on the front porch rocking. Hallelujah. And then all of a sudden, the chair will be rocking. And I'll be gone. Hallelujah. You know, you have to understand that God wants the joy and His strength to be a part of who you are. He doesn't want you just to think, dear God, everything's going downhill from here. No, He wants you to think, you know, the older we get, the closer we're getting to Him. Hello? I mean, you know, you can be 2 and still be close to Him. But if you are, you know, 92, and if you've been getting close to Him since you were 2, you ought to be really close by 92. Hallelujah. You ought to know where your home is and where you're going and who God is and what God's doing in your life. So, let's go over to, I thought I'd use the story, the woman with the issue of blood. Everybody knows it. It's over in Mark. Let's go to Mark chapter 5. But I said, you know, help. I hear people say, help, I'm sick. And there are folks out there that are really sick. I'm not trying to say that people are not sick, because they are. But I'm trying to say there is a great physician that has come in town. There's a great physician who has invaded the doctor and the physician arena. The great physician has burst in on the scene. That no matter how many ratings throughout the nation a doctor that you go to, a physical doctor you may go to is, the great physician has invaded that area. He has come in, and when they run out, he takes over. Hallelujah. Matter of fact, he'll take over even before then if you will let him. But we get comfortable with sickness. I'm just going to say that. We get comfortable with sickness. We pull it to our bosom. It becomes a part of who we are. Until we make it, we learn to live our lives with certain things happening in our bodies. And so instead of trying to get rid of it, we try to make a comfort zone for it. Is anybody listening to me? I mean, all you have to do is listen to yourself. All you have to do, everything we do, whether we're talking about insurance or whether we're talking about this or whether we're talking about that, or where we all the time you go do is just talk about the doctors and this, that, and the other. Listen to yourself. Many times we are absolutely spending all of our time talking about whatever's wrong with us and yet making room for it, making a space for it, instead of trying to get it out of us. Well, this is really an amen group tonight. Hallelujah. Instead of taking the name of Jesus and saying, you know, you did not come, that illness did not come to stay. And don't make it, it's just passing through, and you're going to help it get on through. Hallelujah. Don't make a comfort zone for it, no matter what the medical profession has said. Now, we thank God for the medical profession. Don't misunderstand me. We work hand in glove with the medical profession. But you have to learn to push out things using the power of Jesus' name. Now, the other thing that happens a lot, and again, you know, I'll come back over to Mark in a minute. But the other thing that happens to us is that we get so comfortable with whatever's going on to us. And I say that we almost make a place for it to such an extent that we don't even know how to live without it. And the thought of living without it is uncomfortable because you've put your whole life around it and made a space for it. I'm repeating myself, but I want you to hear what we do, not what God does, what we do. And there are folks now that have gotten so comfortable, and when I say comfortable, I don't mean that the pain is gone. I mean you learn how to take care of things yourself. And you learn how to take care of things yourself, and if you can just take care of them, who needs Jesus? Why do we need Jesus to help us with something we think we can handle? And I'm telling you, you won't turn to Him. If you think you can handle it, you're not going to ask Him to handle it. And if it gets too bad for you, you'll start asking Him. But in the meantime, you've already made a comfort path for it. And then in order to get it out, you've got to chop its head off. And you've got to take a stand and say, you will not do that to me in Jesus' name. I will not live my life with you directing my life, you demon from hell. You will not, because Jesus died on the cross for me. And when He died and took care of my sin, He also took care of my sickness. That's what my Bible says. And if He did it, then I'm going to give Him a chance to take care of it. Hallelujah. But in order to take care of it, you know, if I've got my precious book here and I want you to take care of my book, I've got to give it to you, you know. And if I don't give it to you, I can bring it over to you like I'm going to give it to you. But unless I literally take my hands off of it, you can't do anything. You can say, I'm helping you. You can, we'll share it. You can say, we'll share. Now, there are a lot of people who are sharing sickness. There are a lot of people sharing sickness. So, you know, and if, you know, if you're going to, you know, if I'm giving to you, and if you're Jesus, you need to be stronger than me, honey. That's right. Okay, hallelujah, glory to God. You know, don't let me just stare and say, well, I don't know, I've gotten kind of used to this. And then what happens, we wake up to Jesus after it's almost too late. And we take care of ourselves, and then when we can't, we turn to Jesus. I almost entitled this, Does God Expect Something From Me? The answer is yes, he does. And that's where we mess up a lot. All right, let's go over again. We're talking about getting this sickness. Help, I'm sick. No, I'm going to give you some help. No, you think you're sick. Jesus says you're not sick, so we got a problem. Yes. Oh, I worship Jesus. I magnify Jesus. But Jesus says, by his stripes, I'm healed. And I'm saying, but Jesus, I don't think you included me in this little round because I know I'm sick. And so instead of telling everybody, stand with me, agree with me, agree with me that I'm who God says I am, he thinks I'm healed. How come I think I'm sick? It's a mind thing. Now, don't misunderstand me. The body's there and the body, but the body, the mind will keep that body in a location. Are you listening to me? Your mind will keep you stationed right here. Your mind will make you think you can't move. Your mind will do it because you have gotten accustomed to how your mind has dealt with this thing. I'm not saying you're not sick. I'm saying Jesus said you're not sick. I'm not saying that you don't think you're sick. I'm saying according to Jesus, you are not sick. According to the medical profession, you may be sick. And then what you have to decide is what you think about you. Now, if you think you're sick, you're sick. Anybody with me? If you think you're sick, you're sick. You know, so we got to get you thinking you are not sick. And then that's where everybody says, but I am sick. You want me to say I'm not sick when I know I'm sick. I mean, I know I'm sick. Now, you would be surprised how many people will say that. How many people, they'll come up in a prayer line and you pray for them. And the first thing they'll do is check out, see if it worked. And if it didn't work, they will then say, it didn't work. We need to do it again. Now, a lot of times the reason it doesn't work is because you're not working with it. When you come up to a prayer line, before you even come, you should be saying, this is mine. When hands are laid on me, I'm going to get this. And hell, you're getting off of me. Sickness, you are going in Jesus' name. And pain, you will bow. You are not greater than my God. And that's when we all need to agree together. We do need each other. We need each other to hold us up. We don't need each other to keep us in the same position. That's what we don't need people to say, oh my, you know, they're just going to be there. They're just there. Oh my. No, we need somebody to say, let's get out of this. Yes. Now, let me tell you, if you've gotten accustomed and you are babying the sickness and you've gotten accustomed to it, you're going to get mad with somebody who tries to make you turn it loose. You're going to get mad about it. I mean, how do I know this? I have walked these roads. Hallelujah. I'm telling you. Now, you know the story of the woman with issue of blood. Let's go over there. But she does some very good points about what I'm talking about. It starts in verse 25. It says, a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years. Now, I've preached so many messages on this, but I want to point something different about it. Here we go. And had suffered many things of many physicians and had spent all that she had and was nothing better but rather grew worse. So here's somebody who had gone to every doctor in town and had not gotten better. She spent every dime she had. There is nothing in here that says that she had ever come to God. There's nothing that says that. Nothing that says that she had ever even inquired of the Lord. Now, I'm not just talking about Jesus being there. In the Old Testament, God was the healer.
Amen.
So God's been in the healing business not just since Jesus showed up on earth down here and we called him Jesus. God's always been in. I am the Lord that healeth thee. That's an Exodus scripture. I am the Lord that healeth thee. And it does not in any way look like she asked anything about the Lord healing her. It appears that what she did was she must have had a little bit of money, and she went to every physician, every specialist. And all they did was take her money. I'm not saying they were trying to take her money. They just couldn't help her. She was at the end of the rope, and she didn't realize there was some hope there. She didn't realize there was hope. But she heard about Jesus. So this is what you're hearing me tell you things now. So she heard. And when she heard of Jesus, now matter of fact, through all the doctors, she's at her worst place now before she really began to hear. The worst state she had been in, that's what it says. It said that she didn't get any better, she got worse. And she heard about Jesus, and then when she heard of Jesus, she came in the press behind him and touched his garment. And she was saying something the whole time. And she was saying, just like you're saying something the whole time, oh, dear God, my back hurts. Oh, dear Lord, my leg hurts. Oh, dear God, my foot's killing me right now. Oh, hallelujah. Just like you're sitting there right now. Well, she'd shut up and pray for my knee. Glory to God. Hallelujah. help me get out of here. Oh, God, I can't half hear her. Pray for my ears. Dear God. You know, we all do it. We all just saying something. You know, you wake up in the middle of the night and somebody's talking. Nothing makes me any madder. You wake up in the middle of the night and the devil's just talking. You didn't ask him to say a word. And he's just a-talking. You're a failure. Nothing's going to work for you. This will go backfire on you. This is not going to work. Blah, blah, blah. They all hate you. That's all I know. When I hear that one, I know it's a lie. I said, they love me. So I'm really glad when it gets to the they hate you part, because right there I wake up, they love me. Hallelujah. See, you better get something settled down in your heart. All right, so here she is now. So she comes, but she keeps saying, you know, she says, if I can touch his clothes, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I'm not doing a teaching, but it's the tallit and all that. I'm trying to point something out to you. And straightway, the fountain I shall behold. And straightway, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself, the only place in the Bible where Jesus felt something, the only place in the Bible where the person who was sick felt anything when they were prayed for. And yet all of us want to make a church of the feeling. I'm the pastor of the church that feels things when they're healed. That is non-scriptural. All right, so here we go. Oh, I didn't feel nothing. I guess I didn't get it. Oh, well, go sit down. You're not going to get it. No, no, here we go. And straightway, the fountain of her blood dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue, power, had gone out of him. Isn't that funny? He prayed for thousands of people, and one time he felt something. Felt the power go. Now, that's for all of you who, you know, you ought to be, you know, come up to getting, you know, you come to church sometimes, you don't feel nothing. You know, there are mornings I wake up, I think, I don't want to go today to church. And then, you know, I hear this voice that says, you're the pastor. You know? I say, oh, hallelujah. But, you know, and you don't feel anything. You know, you lay hands on something. There's so many times I can tell you I've laid hands on people. And when I did, there are times I feel, I can feel something go into them like that. And then there are other times I lay the hands on and they don't mean nothing, and they jump up and they're healed instantaneously. So obviously, whether I feel it or you feel it, doesn't mean anything. It's where your belief system is. And anyway, it goes on and it says that, and he asked, who touched my clothes? Of course, there's just thousands around him. And his disciples said to him, blah, 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 the whole multitude, blah, blah, blah. And then he says, daughter, thy faith. She says, well, you know, I've got to tell him it was me, because he won't turn this loose. And he said, daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace and behold of thy plague. Now, the point here, help me, I'm sick. Now, she didn't go through the multitude saying, I'm sick. Matter of fact, if they had found out she was sick, and she was sick. If they had found out she was sick, they would have stoned her. But she came through there saying something. And obviously, remember, she wasn't saying, dear God, don't let them see me out here. The only thing on her mind was, she'd already settled it somewhere. Somewhere she had settled it. The time when she heard about him, she settled it. If I can get to him. And, you know, I'm sure my prayer and yours would be, now help me. Don't let these Pharisees see me. Don't let any of these officers see me. They have the right to stone me. I know that. And my mind would be going that way. But if it's going that way, it can't go on. If I can but touch him, I would be healed. You're going to lose some of that power. So you're going to have a split decision. And so you're not going to be able to make it. So you've got to make up your mind. You know, I'm going to Jesus. That's who I'm going to. And she obviously had already decided, if they discover me, if they find me, no matter what happens, I've got to work with him, because she knew she had to go to him. How many of you know Jesus could have healed him just as good with her at home there? She could have sent a friend down. Because we've had other stories in here where they sent their friends down. She could have sent a friend, you know, there's a woman, blah, 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 and told about the woman. But no, she had decided, I'm going to work with him. I figured this out. He's the one I need. And if I can get to him, I'll be fine. And she had settled that. So the whole distance of the way, she was saying, if I can touch him. If I can touch him, if I can but touch him, if I can but touch him. She wasn't saying, keep the outlaws away from him. No, if I can but touch him, if I can but touch him, keep the judges away from him. No, she wasn't saying that. If I can touch him, what are you saying? What are you saying? Help me, I'm sick. What are you saying? Do I have to do something? Yes. You have to work with him. You have to transform your mind. You have to grab hold of the healing that he has provided. Yes, you have to do something. And you have to get your mind straight so that you can say, he's the one I need. He's the one. And I don't care if I die on my way to him. I'm going to where he is. Because you have settled the issue and you begin your journey. Now, some of you are just waiting for God to come in your house and knock you side of the head and say, be healed. Hallelujah. No, he has already put it out there. By my stripes, you're healed. By my stripes, he's waiting for you to grab hold of it and said, you know, this book is all I need. This book is all I need. This book is God talking to me. And I found my name in here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm a child of the King. Hallelujah. And he died for me. And so Psalm 103 includes me. I mean, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. What are his benefits? He heals all my diseases and forgiveth all my iniquities. Notice that the healing, he healeth. The benefit, he healeth. Look at your neighbor and say, I have a benefit. It says, written on my policy. I just found it. There is a benefit, you will not believe it. This benefit is written in blood on my policy. And the benefit says, by his stripes, I am healed. And then you say, body, do you get that? I am healed. I didn't say that. Jesus said it. And I'm agreeing with him. Hallelujah. See, that's you doing something. That's you changing your whole focus. Until they're all that you want at any point in life, you just want Jesus. You don't want anything else? You want him. You've looked at all the choices there are out there. You know what? I want him. I take Jesus. He's the one I want. He is my healer. He is my deliverer. He is my King of Kings and my Lord of Lords. And guess what? He's coming back real soon. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God is a good God. All the time. Please follow us. Keep up with what's happening around us and watch our podcasts. Watch our YouTube channels. We tell you so many things that can change your life forever. I'm thankful that you're following us. God bless.